So go ahead, answer me. What was that first question? Was I a photographer first, a motorsport fan second, or was there a motorsports fan? And, I think the latter. I think I was a car person, a car guy. In my teens, and even before that, my dad had a big Packard, and those. I was born in 29, so in the 30s, he was involved with the American Legion, and I'd sit in the big Packard, go up the State Street Parade, in the back. So it was, that whole thing was, wow, and.
Was he a mechanic too? No?
No. He was just a guy, a great guy. Married my mom, came along, she had some money, and the marriage lasted quite a while. I have one other brother, who's no longer, I'm the last one that's still alive.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Do you think it was more dad's influence or mom's influence?
Oh, for sure, the dad. I think, yeah. Because he was eager. He was an active amateur photographer and loved to shoot movies with his, 16 mil or something.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. But my mother and dad split while I was still a little boy. And that was very traumatic. Went back to East Boston with my mom and didn't see my dad again for a couple of years. And then, then I was in school back there, and and suddenly got a letter from telegram from my brother, Pop's gone, he's dead.
Oh.
So one of those things that,
So you never got a chance to talk to him at
the end of his life? No, okay. Yeah.
Yeah, that leaves a big hole.
It does, for sure.
Yeah.
A really, really big hole, yeah.
But you had gone east.
With my mom, 1939.
Where did you go to school?
Well, it's really a great question. Because I was in high school here. Now, let me get this straight now. No, because I was, when I went east with my mom, I was 10 or 11 years old. We lived for a while in Boston. And then my mom remarried. And we sort of got involved with New England and all that and went to a prep school. First was on West Newton called Fessenden. Then I went on to Pomfret in Connecticut.
You went to Pomfret in Connecticut?
Yeah, a few years. And then my very last year of that period, I went off to California and went into senior high school here. And I always like to say I discovered women, girls, in a regular high school, which was an extraordinary experience for me.
Well, because Pomfret was a boys' school.
Absolutely.
Right? Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
What a nightmare.
The girls came from some place down in Providence for a
dance.
Monthly dance, that whole thing.
Yes.
Yeah. Very sheltered sort of. Yeah.
So you were really coming to motorsport photography from the combination of being a car fan.
Yes.
And your father sounds like he had some influence.
I think that's very, very fair to say. Yeah. But then also I grew up as a kid in World War II, and there was Life magazine.
Mm. Mm.
All these pictures.
The images.
That's how I sort of, Robert Capa, who the hell's that? Look at these pictures. D-Day. These guys coming ashore. Wow, there's photographers.
And Margaret Burke White.
Burke White, of course.
And, she wound up being our next door neighbor in Connecticut.
Wow.
And she had Parkinson's. So she was essentially at home all the time.
Yeah.
But she loved to have visitors. So the three of us would go over and visit her, not knowing who she was.
Well, sure. Yeah, I think I remember now when you guys were there, it was about her being a neighbor. Yeah. Legendary character. In my studio, I have little snapshot that somebody took of her on top of her station wagon. She's setting up a big view camera. Kidding. Yeah.
It's amazing. She didn't get killed by the view camera.
Yeah.
So how did you get to start to cover the European side?
Well, I credit my first wife. She said, "Jesse, we got to go to Europe." This was in early 1950s, 51 or 52. I said, "Oh." So we went over there, I think in 51 or 52, and we rented bikes. We bicycled for a while in England and then in France and around, which was strange, but a great introduction to that part of the world.
And of course, it's sort of in post-war condition.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah, I remember going to, for some reason, to Darmstadt in Germany. That place was still in ruins.
Ruins, yeah.
Yeah.
But people were clearly working hard to rebuild.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. But we decided, my first wife, Patricia, we went down to Switzerland. And we rented a house down in Switzerland. It seemed like a very attractive place and interesting, and that's where it all sort of took off, living there in the heart of Europe.
Were you photographing general images at that
point? Yeah, I was sure, a happy snapper. Yeah,
happy snapper.
Yeah. I loved it. And of course, Switzerland was such a photogenic.
Mm.
We were right in the middle of the tourist area, you know, it was lovely.
Were you in
Canton Bern?
In Canton Bern, okay.
Yeah,
sure.
In the middle of the, yeah.
That area, the Bernese area, is where Sue's family was from.
Where?
Bern was her, you know, her name was Zessiger.
I'm missing that first name.
Sue Zessiger.
And who is that?
That's the mother of Lillian Walker.
Oh, okay.
You know, you remember Sue.
Yeah.
Right?
Sure.
But her family was Swiss.
Okay.
And from the Bern area.
Okay.
So.
Yeah.
I went there. I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. I mean, I still have lots of friends there.
Do you?
No, yeah. We don't correspond or anything, but I mean, I could go there tomorrow and, wow, how are you? Yeah.
Great.
Such a long time ago. And it's, of course, it's very different now. Much more crowded and built up and everything. But those mountains are still there.
Yep. So what was the first race that you remember?
You know, I've been looking at some of those magazines from England when we were over there. And there are pictures of races at the French circuit, Reims,
mm-hmm.
R-E-I-M-S. Mm-hmm. I guess they had Reims or Reims.
Mm.
And Mercedes was, I saw one magazine, Mercedes is getting this car ready for the Reims, and this W196 showed up, and I was there.
It was like from outer space.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Exactly.
And I think I was sort of freelancing with some magazine, or I don't know which, maybe it was Sports Cars Illustrated or something. Probably made it. Yeah, I think there was one guy, editor of SCI, who wanted me to do some stuff for him. Yeah, that's where it all started. And then I met Carl Ludvigsen.
You did.
He was a good friend.
Yeah.
And we, all of that germinated over there.
Was Bernard Cahier?
Cahier, yeah.
Was there,
he was there
at
too,
the same
yeah.
time, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
Was he? But he was more writing, and
yeah, but he was a happy snapper too. He took pictures. Denise
McCluggage. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, she was there. There were a few Americans, Henry Manny, guys like that. Yeah, we were a pretty small group. Yeah.
Did you know Gurney before he came on the scene?
No.
No.
No. Dan, yeah. No. I forget where we first saw him. I think maybe Monaco on a Grand Prix there. 62 or something. He's in a Porsche.
Yeah, in the image you took.
Yeah.
He's in
yeah.
that second row.
Yeah, back there.
Black
yeah.
helmet.
Yeah.
Right.
I don't know if I have anything earlier than him. Of him, though. Yeah. Great guy. I have a few great pictures of Dan in those, in the Ferrari. I think the Ferrari, yeah. Targa Florio. Sicily. A little bit different. I have a pretty good library of those guys. Yeah.
Has Evie ever asked you for images?
I don't think so.
Wow, I wonder why. Because, you know, she's been working on the book, on Dan's big book for, it's not finished.
Yeah.
But.
It's not finished yet.
No.
Mm.
No.
Who's doing the writing?
I know, she is.
Yeah.
And it's. I think it's also a collection of other people's.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah. Well, she may have found something that I wrote way back.
Maybe.
Way back when, yeah.
Well, that's what I suspected, was that you came to motorsport already as a seeing photographer.
Yeah, right? yeah. I mean, I remember going to that first race in France at Reims. Yeah, like a, it was amazing. Yeah, of course I ruined my ears over years.
But that's when you could get really close to the track.
Absolutely.
And you were lying down and
getting, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And I even shot some 16 mil at that time too. I was thinking to myself, oh, this would be make it look a little movie. Well, you know, but I
is that footage around?
Oh yeah, it's in the archive, part of the archive. Yeah.
Have you ever looked at it?
Some of it, but not a hell of a lot. There's one or two clips and one of and there's a CD about my work, but yeah, it's ancient days ago, long time ago.
Yeah, but well, it sounds like somebody digitized it already.
Yeah, we all the really jewels I like to think are all digitized.
Great.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Super.
Yeah, I've had some good help with that. I have a guy who comes every week and helps me with the computer and the archive. And
good.
I'm still selling prints.
That's great.
Yeah. I've got an order for a big 30 by 40 of a Maserati, you know.
Oh, great.
From one of my galleries. I got four or five galleries that have my work around.
Nice.
Yeah. One in London, one in LA, and one in New York, and I know.
Yes. Good.
Yeah.
All right. What's next?
Oh, as our work and unfolded, when was the moment you realized that this could be a trademark career? I'm not sure about that. I jotted it down thinking of something about Ansel Adams, and because I was very much, I knew his work, and just discovering that whole European scene with my camera was so inspiring, inspirational, and I was able to do it. I didn't have to, 9 to 5 kind of, you know, and the SCI connection, Sports Illustrated connection, and started moving some pictures of, anyway.
So the income was coming from magazine work?
Yeah, then, yeah, yeah.
Not print selling?
Well, some of mine, we were well looked after, you know.
Yeah.
Mom and Dad, yeah.
Were you printing in Europe?
Yeah, I had a dark room.
You had a dark
room. Sure, yeah.
So you could see your finished image.
Absolutely, yeah.
And adjust it the way you wanted.
The way we wanted it, yeah. Right now at the studio in Carpinteria, I have an assistant. We've been going through the work and organizing and labeling it, and you know, we're getting make real progress. I mean, there's a lot of 11 by 14s and a few 8 by 10s and 16 by 20s, and you know, yeah, there's a lot of, it's a huge archive.
But if you're in the darkroom printing an image for the first time, that you haven't seen it yet, and now it's appearing in the developer.
Yeah.
What is the conversation that's going on in your head about saying, geez, this is really good?
That's a really wonderful question. Yeah, I think that was, oh, wow, the surprise. Wow, oh, was that a speck of dust? Did I, you know, yeah.
Well, I think the moment that the artist realizes that he's making something that he's satisfied with or he's excited about.
Yeah.
I'm trying to figure out when that happened for you.
Yeah, that's a really great question. Maybe in the 1970s.
In the 70s?
Maybe in the 1970s, I don't know. It's a tough one to answer.
Was it at all in the dark room in Switzerland?
Yeah.
Yeah?
I had a beautiful dark room down on the bottom of the house, yeah.
But you must have been excited about your own work at that point, too.
Sure, right? It must have been, yeah.
It must have been.
And looking ahead and at that time, wow, next week it's Brescia, Mille Miglia. Week after that it's Rouen or something, you know.
Yeah.
The calendar was full.
Sure.
Yeah. We lived in Switzerland and with my first wife, and the Porsche factory was just up the road in a way. We an hour and a half quick drive up to Stuttgart.
Up to Stuttgart, right.
Zuffenhausen to go get a brand new 356 for like should buy that $2,500 or something. I don't know. Yeah, I knew all those guys that are at Zuffenhausen.
Who was running the show in 356 days?
In Zuffenhausen? Well, Ferry was, I don't know when the old man died, but Ferry was there. He was Dr. Porsche.
Yeah.
Yeah. There was this other factory across the street from Zuffenhausen, you know, where a lot of the work was going on, the racing shop.
The Weissach.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. In those days was wonderful.
Well, it seems to me that there's two moments. One is the first time the image appears to you.
Yeah.
And then 3 or 4 months later, you receive the magazine with your image in it.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah, exactly.
And that's a proud moment.
Took forever to
come
and see it. Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Yeah, I was always shipping pictures over there and across the ocean, you know. Yeah.
When did you come back to USA?
I think in the early 60s, I think, or middle 60s. And that was a divorce. And came back, lived in San Francisco for a while, and I met Nancy in San Francisco. And started another chapter. But at that point, I had a couple of galleries there were a couple of galleries that had my work.
Just motorsport work or other images too?
Pretty much just motorsport work, I think. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what my pigeonhole is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But that hasn't stopped you from doing other work that you really are interested in.
No, I'm always, don't know, well, we have a cars and coffee thing every Sunday. I go up there and I'm shooting birds and yeah. And the whole digital thing is a new, whole new world, of course.
Yeah.
For me to learn how to, I mean, using the camera is not a big deal, but once you get that card out of the camera and put it in the computer and all that shit, that's, I mean, that's...
Yeah.
That's a big, big deal.
And I think none of us who started with film could foresee what was going to really be a great tool, which was the digital tool.
Exactly, you know? Yeah.
It's a great tool.
Yeah, yeah. It's quite amazing. I'm thankful that I have a little help on that side of the thing, technical stuff.
And yeah.
I mean, once a week, my guy from, he lives down in Ventura, comes up, and we're very good friends. He's a good photographer, and we have a great time. And, I couldn't really be functioning without him.
Yeah. What's his name?
Robert Fields.
Robert Fields. I don't think I've met
him. Robert Fields, yeah.
I didn't meet him.
His specialty is travel. He's just been on a big cruise around Europe on a big cruise ship, and he's really active shooter. And he's been teaching me how to print. I can usually do a pretty good digital print now.
Yeah.
Yeah. But often one of the galleries wants a big 30x40.
Yeah.
Well, getting that little card over the camera and taking it down to the Sammy's where they've got a good guy who can, you know, within a couple of days I got a 30x40.
Yeah.
Know?
And no mess. No mess.
No mess. Yeah.
That's when.
Yeah.
I don't know what this is trying to tell me here. Oh, my battery. Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
What was the next? I like it when you read the question because.
At your early work unfolded, when was the moment you realized that this could be a trademark career for you? I really don't know.
Well,
I just don't
know. We got some good stuff on that.
Yeah, so. Yeah. What was your thinking about your own positioning versus others doing similar work? Whom did you admire? Well, I admired a guy named Clement Haskey.
Yeah.
Shot before the war.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah.
Because of his image or because of the subject matter?
Both. Both, yeah.
Because his photography always reminded me of who was the great French turn of the century?
Lartigue?
Just post that.
I don't know.
Long street shots of
Cartier-Bresson?
Cartier-Bresson.
Yeah, of course. It's very funny. At Lee Mann's, the year that Ford arrived, I was down there in the pits in practice, and a photographer friend was there with me, and he said, "Jesse, you know who that guy is there?" "No, that's Cartier-Bresson." "Holy shit." And I took a few pictures of him, of this guy, working away with his Leica down. You know, he was there with taking pictures of the Ford in the pits.
Oh, that's great.
HCB, Henri Cartier-Bresson. I mean, he was number one for me. I mean,
yeah,
he was extraordinary. We collect photographs. I've got a few
of
his. Yeah.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, a high watermark for sure.
Yeah.
How about people who were doing what you were doing at the same time?
Well, there was Henry Manny.
Yep.
An American guy. He's a good friend. Denise had a Leica. And Phil would often have a Leica around his neck.
Really? Phil Hill?
And there's going to be a book coming out soon of Phil's pictures.
Oh, good.
Yeah, yeah. And I got to know Sterling, Peter Collins, and all these guys were friends.
Yeah.
Sterling is not doing very well, I think. He's in Singapore or some hospital. I don't know. I have no news at all about him.
Oh, I didn't hear.
Yeah.
Because he fell, didn't he? Didn't he fall down the elevator?
Yes, that was early on, I think.
Come here, sweetheart. Come here.
Yeah, he had an accident in an elevator at his place in London. But yeah. That's ancient history. This is... He's got some... I don't know what happened. But anyway, I don't think it's very good. But.
You're under here.
And I admire the work of, like, Elliot Erwitt and Pictures of Rome. And I've got all these damn books, which I always collecting a lot of books, photography books. All these guys are my heroes. And the whole Magnum book, you know, that's... What was that? Kappa and all those famous guys.
Was Magnum the agency?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And there were a select bunch of... And all these guys were part of the Magnum... business they invested in, you know, it was a cooperative kind of thing for a while.
Were you jealous of that arrangement, or
jealous?
Well, did you try to? Did you join any of the agency?
I don't think so, but of course, if Nancy were to receive, oh, Jesse, you remember something? well, I had an agency in New York early on, and I would send some pictures on to them. Yeah. A smaller agency.
Yeah.
And they loved the work. Nancy Palmer agency. So the answer to your question is yes, I had an agency in New York, but not nearly like these guys, the big shots.
The big shots.
Yeah. I mean, this guy, Elliot Erwitt, my hero. Yep. The coffee table is loaded.
Yeah, looks like my coffee table. I never get to the bottom of the pile.
Exactly, yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, oh dear.
What else?
What else? What's that last question there?
As a man who's risen to the top of his craft, are you satisfied? Are you proud? Are you still searching for talent or the image? Yeah, I think I'm constantly challenged these days with the technical side of it. You know, I've got to take a lot of pictures and I take the card down and I put it in and got to download it. And, you know, a lot of steps. I have these cheat sheets which set up for, I could steps.
You know, yeah. That's good.
It's a whole new ball game.
But, you know, when you look back on film and you look at the number of steps that it took to get to the result, each one of those steps was potentially fatal. Wasn't it?
True. Easily enough. You could get the exposure off or the,
yeah,
the film getting it loaded correctly or all kinds of things.
And if it's not on the negative, you're not getting it back.
You betcha.
Right?
Yeah.
So the amazing thing about this stuff is that even most of the time, all the information is there. You just have to get it out.
Yeah, exactly. You know? Yeah. And... a big enough file to make a good size print.
To make a good size print, yeah.
Not just a little one, but got them, these JPEGs and the bigger ones. You know, it's a challenge for me. You know, I need help.
I understand about the technical challenge, but what I was searching for was your enthusiasm for current work.
Oh, I'm eager. I love to go to Cars and Coffee on Sunday. Well, I love to capture the birds in the bird bath out there with mm-hmm. the long, you know. Yeah, I love it. I'm still doing it.
Yeah, that's what I suspected.
Sure, sure. I love to do portraits. Women. I've got images of actors and actresses and dancers in my archive. You know, a lot of stuff other than the motorsport. It's a big archive.
When's that going to...
That's a very good question. We're in the middle of that right now.
Okay, so there's a plan to bring that forward.
We haven't resolved where it's all going to go yet, but...
Uh-huh.
You know, there's some possibilities. Do you know anything about the Revs Foundation?
No.
No, it's down in Florida.
Oh, from what's his name?
Yeah. I don't know.
The great collector, Miles.
Right? Miles Collier.
Miles Collier. That's the Rebs.
That's
guy.
The guy. Yeah,
yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. And a couple of my colleagues have already given him a lot of their archive.
As a sort of a place to put stuff.
Yeah. So I'm really in no rush to figure out where it's all going to go. But if I should go tomorrow, my son and my daughter Andy will be in charge of all of it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I think we're all on the same wavelength, so it's going to be good.
Good.
Yeah.
Well, I think this is great.
I'm sure you got some good stuff.
I think we got some good stuff. Yeah. Can I take a picture?
Of course.